Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to the Bottom of the Barrel. Tonight we're going to be taking a look at SmackDown's first pay-per-view, as is the new brand extension, WWE Backlash, which had plenty of backs and not really any lashing. I mean, you know, no one took off their belts and whipped anybody, and certainly, I was kind of confused by the reason why they chose Backlash as the first one. Frankly, the one that they're going to be having in Sacramento, which I can't afford to go to. No Mercy, probably should have been what this one was called. Considering the fact that No Mercy makes sense, you know, when you're starting off this way. But Backlash indicates that something happened before this, and that there is a equal and opposite reaction. Hell, that's what Shane McMahon's little promo thing at the beginning of the show when the pay-per-view was starting, that the pre-recorded thing that they had, that's what this was all about. But there's no real backlash. What are they backlashing? Whatever. This is the Backlash pay-per-view. We had the pre-show. One match on the pre-show was Apollo Crews versus Baron Corbin, made last minute. Match was all right. I gave it a C. It was about what you expect from these two when they get in the ring. Apollo Crews not really picking up many victories. Baron Corbin picking up a win, which probably will mean nothing for him because he barely gets any TV time. So, woo! Then we start off the event with the pay-per-view from the brand that's all about the wrestlers. And it starts with the commissioner and the GM talking. Admittedly, it was short, and it leads into the six-pack challenge match for the women's championship. Becky Lynch versus Natalya versus Naomi versus Alexa Bliss versus Carmella versus Nikki Bella. They went quite a while in this matchup without any pinfalls or submissions. In the end, we got a fast-paced sort of elimination. I was wrong. I was wrong a lot on this one, but frankly, going into this pay-per-view, I really couldn't find myself caring very much. So it was hard to make predictions on something that I just couldn't give fucks about. In the long run, we had a decent matchup. Storylines continued. We had Alexa Bliss was the first to be eliminated by a double team with Naomi and Natalya. Natalya then eliminates Naomi. Nikki Bella manages to eliminate Natalya with Carmella immediately eliminating her. Finally, Becky Lynch picks up the win, becomes the new women's champion for SmackDown with the disarmer over top Carmella. Decent fast-paced match, better than I actually expected it to be. I gave the match a B. And we have that going on for us there. You have Miz backstage meeting up with some kid who has a show on Nickelodeon where he travels around the world. So basically it's just another show where someone gets to show off what they can afford to do and we middle-class people can't. So fuck you too. Miz basically gets shown up by this kid. Have your people call my people, blah, blah, blah. I don't know if this kid did anything else before this, but I don't know who he is. I don't care who he is. I don't have television service, so I don't know what the fuck's on Nickelodeon anymore. We then cut backstage to Bray Wyatt laying out Orton and slamming a door into his ankle. And, you know, whether or not Orton would be able to wrestle was left up in the air. We then have the Usos versus the Hype Bros to determine which team will go on to face Slater and Rhino in the finals of the tag team tournament. Which the best guess I could think of why they did this whole bit was basically they didn't want American Alpha to lose to Slater and Rhino. Both of the Usos are wearing, like, grills in their mouth now with, like, some sort of weird... One of them looked like they were wearing fake vampire teeth. The other one had some sort of weird, like, stuff on the bottom of his mouth. And I'm like, I don't understand what's the point of this. It was just distracting. Which is kind of weird that I'd be spending more time looking at their teeth than what they're actually doing in the ring. But it was that distracting. Match-wise, this wasn't bad. The Hype Bros had some really close shots before getting beaten by the Usos. I gave the match a C+. Not too bad. You have an interview with Slater and Rhino backstage, and then Slater goes to walk away and then walks back to Rhino and basically starts talking about bad imitation crab meal that he may have gotten from his wife. And it's a silly bit, and it's like, we're still on the air. Apparently, also, they had this whole thing that Rhino doesn't like being slapped on the shoulders. And they went absolutely nowhere with this. You would think that with a setup, like a clear setup where he was like smacking him on the shoulder and he's like getting irritated and smacking him on the shoulder and he's getting irritated, that maybe, you know, at some point he'd still do a blind tag and Rhino would get irritated and lay him out, but nope, that didn't happen. Why? Because WWE likes to set you up for absolutely nothing. Getting your $9.99 worth there. We are then moving on to the Intercontinental Championship match. Dolph Ziggler makes his way out to the ring, but we go backstage to The Miz, who is trying to hold up Daniel Bryan for pretty much more money or a better contract. He says he's going to renegotiate the contract and insults Bryan. When I wrote this down, I said I expected Bryan to cost him the Intercontinental title and fire him. That didn't work out that way. Frankly, I'm kind of glad it didn't, because what we got was honestly the best match Miz has ever had. Ever. And I'm hard-pressed to say this, but this was by far one of the most enjoyable matches on the show. Intercontinental Championship, The Miz versus Dolph Ziggler. We had the audience get split 50-50, half chanting, "Let's go, Miz," and the other half chanting, "Let's go, Ziggler," which was just weird. Miz at one point started taking stuff out of Daniel Bryan's playbook, including the repeated running turnbuckle drop kicks. It was clearly that there's still something going on there, and it again brings up the question, will they let Daniel Bryan wrestle one more matchup? Maybe something, you know, where Miz's contract is on the line or the Intercontinental Championship's up for grabs. One more time where he wins it and then relinquishes it. I don't know, but, you know, maybe there's something that they're rethinking about it. It's hard to say. Any way you look at it, The Miz put on a great show and showed some real toughness in that matchup, and Dolph Ziggler always puts on a great show. Final score for that match was a B. I was very impressed. Yeah, like I said, best Miz match ever. Now, that's to say, can he go upward from there, or was it just that he happened to be working with somebody really good? But then again, I've seen him and Dolph Ziggler wrestle before, and they weren't necessarily spectacular matches, but they were given a chance to do something, and there was story involved, and it made a better matchup. Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton. Orton was declared that he was not able to compete. Therefore, Bray Wyatt was going to win by forfeit, but Bray Wyatt demanded the official 10 count for the forfeit. And then it was announced that Bray Wyatt now has a no-holds-barred match against Kane. So no grade for Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton because, well, it didn't happen. As for the no-holds-barred match, wasn't all that spectacular of a thing. What you'd expect out of it, I mean, you know, Kane has a limited skill set, he always has, but at this point in his career, he can't move the way he used to, he can't take the big bumps, he can't take the violent shots, and frankly, the way you used to take down Kane was a shit ton of unprotected headshots with chairs. They don't do that anymore. So, a no-holds-barred match with Kane these days just isn't all that spectacular. In the end, Randy Orton, with his ankle wrapped, came out and still hit an RKO on Bray, and then remembered to limp a little bit afterwards, and Bray Wyatt takes a chokeslam and gets pinned 1-2-3 by Kane. For some reason, Orton waited until the referee's back was turned to hit the RKO, because clearly, in a no-holds-barred, no-disqualification matchup, Randy Orton is concerned about getting disqualified. So, yeah, not a real spectacular outing on this particular matchup. I wasn't impressed. And I don't know if Orton is legitimately hurt, if maybe they just think Bray Wyatt isn't worth having him face Orton. I don't know what the hell the WWE was thinking, but maybe they're just like, we really, really, really want Kane to appear on the show and didn't want to have him take out the jobbers that AJ Styles was talking to in the backstage in the next segment. But for whatever reason, you get Kane over Bray Wyatt, and the match that they've been building for the last 3 weeks completely out the window. Speaking of which, AJ Styles then goes backstage and is talking to jobbers and telling them how they'll never make it anywhere. Frankly, that guy who has a gut like mine, I could probably say, yeah, he probably won't ever make it anywhere. This is the biggest thing he's ever going to do. Maybe the other guy who had this indignant look on his face and the long hair might make it. Who knows? Who are they anyway? If somebody knows, you might be from their hometown. Maybe you know something about them. We then move on to the SmackDown Tag Team Championships. The Usos taking on Heath Slater and Rhino. Not a bad matchup. I gave it a C+. Heath Slater did most of the work in the ring. Rhino, minimal, with just a tagged in maybe three times, finally hitting the gore, and Heath Slater picking up the win. So I can say, finally, Heath Slater has a contract. That angle is over. Now we get to see how this weird mismatch of a tag team of Rhino and Heath Slater carry on as the SmackDown Tag Team Champions. Should be interesting to see how that works out. As I mentioned, I gave that match a C+. We then move on to a WWE Network commercial for the Clash of Champions, clearly showing the Sasha Banks versus Charlotte match. Now, for those of you who maybe read rumor sites like NoDQ.com, and there's been supposedly a rumor going down that the people on the network and other stuff are not supposed to advertise this match anymore because supposedly they're going to go with Bayley and Charlotte. Oops. So either the rumor sites are wrong, or people at WWE Network didn't get the message. Either way, frankly, as far as I'm concerned, you know, you can't believe everything you see on the rumor sites, but believe this video. If you're watching it from NoDQ, believe this video. Believe that I am awesome. An awesomely bearded nerd. Yeah. And then went on to the WWE Championship, AJ Styles versus Dean Ambrose. This was a very strange audience, a lot of boos for Dean Ambrose, and the audience pretty solidly behind AJ Styles, despite the fact that Styles was wrestling as the heel on this matchup. In the end, AJ does get one opportunity where the referee gets knocked down. He quickly hits the low blow. That was, of course, you know, teased this last Friday, last Tuesday on SmackDown. I'm used to saying Friday for SmackDown. So last Tuesday on SmackDown when he had felled Dean Ambrose with a kick to the crotch earlier. And hits the Styles Clash, 1-2-3. AJ Styles now stands as only the second man. And I can't count Christian as this one, sorry, because he was the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, not the TNA World Heavyweight Champion. But he's the second man to be TNA Champion and WWE Champion. He's also the second man to be TNA Champion, IWGP Champion, and WWE Champion. The other one being, of course, Kurt Angle. Other IWGP Champions have been WWE Champion, Brock Lesnar. As the match went, you know, it started off kind of slow and bland. I think it picked up. I got much better towards the end there with Dean throwing everything but the kitchen sink, at least legally, at AJ Styles. In the end, AJ becomes the new WWE Champion. I gave the match a B-. Wasn't the highlight of the night, but it started off that I thought was only going to be a CC-plus matchup, turned into something much better. Final score for Backlash, an event that I really came in not expecting anything for, was a B-. And it's because that Women's Championship match and the Intercontinental Championship match and, to a certain extent, the WWE Championship match carried the pay-per-view. The rest of it was still average to above average. The worst match of the night, unfortunately, was Bray Wyatt versus Kane, which probably should have and could have been better. But it wasn't a terrible night. There certainly wasn't anything that was a total stinker that took out the evening. So it was an enjoyable night of WWE wrestling, for what it's worth. Feel free to let me know what your thoughts are on. Did you hate this pay-per-view? Did you love this pay-per-view? Do you feel it was kind of alright like I did? Now feel free to comment below. And as always, please like, share, subscribe. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this barrel's been scraped clean. I will see you guys next week with another SmackDown vs. Raw, I assume. And of course, the Royal Road and Surviving Survivor Series. Catch you guys there.